Brought to you by
Eaton Detroit Spring. Proudly made in the USA.
Classic car or muscle car? We want to show you how to restore your automobile and save yourself some money in the process. Sometimes we consult the pros, sometimes we mess up. But just remember, it's never a problem, it's always a project.
Right now on Autorestomod, we go to Mustang Central and install a four-link rear suspension system from the fine folks at Ridetech.
Honey, what are you doing out there?
Waiting on the next Super Blowout 3-Day Only Mega Sale.
You don't need a sale. You need MPD.
MPD's everyday prices are competitive with most sales, and orders arrive fast from our four strategically located superstores. National Parts Depot has quality parts for Mustang, Camaro, Chevelle, GTO, Firebird, Ford, and Chevy truck. For your free catalog, go online or call toll-free.
Working beats waiting.
All right, folks, we're here at Mustang Central with Alan Sheffley dealing with a four-link from the guys at Ridetech. So, Alan, you've in the past not been real fond of most of the stuff you've seen out there in this line. So what do you think of the new four-link from these guys?
I like it very much because it's much steadier, stable, beefy, however how you want to describe it, piece. So okay. I like that. Very easy to install. Comes with everything you need. You also have the option of a sway bar if you like to use it.
So sway bar would mount on this piece right here. This is
correct.
Now, is it a sway bar specifically from the guys at Ridetech?
Yes.
Or you have to get their sway bar right. For the four-link.
Yeah, and I think you have to order that specifically if you want it or not.
Right.
We're not going to put a sway bar on there. Sway bar does create some exhaust clearance problems. And this system itself does create some exhaust clearance problems.
Now let me ask you this, because you're not putting the sway bar on it. Is it just strictly for exhaust clearance because the car you're putting it on is not going to be done as far as doing a lot of road racing and things like that? Or is it just because, is the coilover system going to be less needy of a rear sway bar?
Yeah, for what he's doing with it. Now
okay.
If it was going to be a track car, I'd want a sway bar, but most of your track cars, serious track cars, don't have exhaust coming out the back anyway.
Right.
So this is kind of a trick street car, throwing some good options at it. And their new design, we're actually the first ones putting it on. They wanted some feedback on it, so we're kind of excited.
And you guys have a pre-production unit. This isn't the one that they're now producing these outright.
Right.
And they've got all the stuff because you feedback to them. They've got all the little issues that you guys ran into putting it in.
Right.
Worked out. Now this unit that we've got here on the table. You guys have already installed this a couple of times, I'm assuming, from doing the work with the guys at Ridetech, but we're going to go in and kind of give the guys a light heads up on how to put this in and set it up and get it ready to go if they so want to do a four-link in a car.
Right.
Now, there's not going to be the ability to drive because the car we're working on is empty.
Yes, in the process of being restored, ground up. It's going to be a very cool car. It's going to have a lot of horsepower, and so we're pretty excited about the whole package, and this adds another little bit of bling to it. And like I say, it's pretty easy to put in. A lot of guys have added sway bars to their cars, so it uses the same similar idea where you drill the holes in the frame rail and you run the bolt through and secure it up. And also, if you'd like, and we're going to, you can come back and weld it in as well, and we're going to do that given the horsepower the car has.
And what kind of horsepower are you going to be running in this car?
It's going to be in the 600 range.
It's amazing what we're getting for power out of these things. And that really makes something like a four-link a much more viable and interesting option, because you know as well as I do, trying to control a leaf sprung or axle under horsepower is going to be kind of tough.
Right.
So with a case like that, coilovers and all are going to make that a much more supple car to work with that kind of power.
Yep.
All right, Alan, well, I guess we need to move this out of the way and get your tall self out from underneath the car so you don't whack your head on something and get busy installing.
Starting to get a neck cramp. But
yeah, it's a big, thick neck. So. All right, first order of business in this, you're going to have to remove your rear axle and your drive shaft out of the car. And when you do that, it's going to open you up to be able to get all this in here. One of the first things you're really going to have to do, though, is you're going to have to take the pinion support right here and cut it down and leave the flange in position. So that later on you can go in and drill these two holes through that flange. That'll give you a little additional support for what you're doing up here with all your brackets and stuff. So we've got all that taken care of. Now we need to get the cradle up in here and start setting it up to drill the holes. So those are already there, but we're going to show you how to put them in yourself. Alan, this is a big old heavy piece, Bubba.
Heavier the better, as far as I'm concerned.
Yep. You've done four links in the past where you've had some problems with that, haven't you?
Yes.
Okay. I'm done here, right?
Not quite. Let's throw a clamp on there. You can get a sore head.
I know this thing, that's probably a really good idea. I've got mine on, go ahead. All right, folks, one of the things you're gonna wanna do with this is clamp this thing into position. And so you can get your measurements correct on it. One of the things you'll run into with these unibody chassis is none of these things are gonna be perfectly straight and level. So you're gonna end up probably having to muck around with this a good bit in order for it to stay tight and set up against the chassis. Well, now that's in there. Now you're gonna probably bang around on this a little bit because we're trying to get it back into our original locator hole.
Our favorite tool. We're just gonna tap it around so that everything is set as high as it can go. And it might be best to just do one side. So you're not fighting the other side. And what you want to do is come in with a belt tip marker and mark the holes in all the locating places. And so you mark these two, and then come over here and do a little adjustment on this side. And then mark your holes here. And then you can go ahead and put your marks on these spots. And
over here as well.
Right, and then you pull it down, drill those holes, and then you slide those U-bolts through there. And
we've already drilled the holes, so we'll just show them how to slide the U-bolts into position.
Right.
All right, you got seven of these little U-bolts to go in. Now, when you put them in, you might think that you would do this and then do that to get them to go through the hole, but what you actually have to do is put it in deep, like I've got that, and drop it into that top hole. You get to do that seven times. All right, here we go. I'm gonna go ahead and put the cradle up in here. Here's your washer. It magically appeared from our camera guy. He's cool like that. For the record, I dropped the washer too, but my belly's big enough that it didn't go all the way to the floor. Doing far better than I thought. All right, we're gonna go ahead and finish bolting this thing into position, and then we're gonna come back and start working on the rest of the setup here on the four link from Ridetech. Okay, now you wanna go in and kind of loosely set this thing in before you do your final tightening. We've got all of our bolts installed. It's kind of hanging on the bolts, so to speak, right now. So Alan's gonna go ahead and go in here and final tighten it up. Now when you're tightening this thing into the chassis, you'll probably want to go in and do the front sections first because those are straight holes. The back ones back here on the chassis are all slotted so you can get it moving toward the front of the car. This first, these last.
On this last bolt here, because of the sway bar brackets, you'll need a 9/16 open end wrench or possibly a speed wrench will fit in there. Okay, we're going to mount the lower axle mount. We're just going to put these on loosely.
All right, now what you're going to want to do is you want to make sure that when you're tightening these U-bolts up that they're pretty much level. You got the same amount of threads on both sides of the U-bolt when you put them on. Okay, you're going to want to install your lower shock mount in the bottom two holes in the bracket. I recommend going ahead and getting the top one started first. The bottom one in there. Okay, we'll final tighten those up to torque spec after we get everything in here final, ready to go.
Okay, we're ready to install the lower control arm and make sure to install it where the grease zerk fitting is pointing down. It goes back in the original location is where the leaf spring was. And it attaches to the top hole of the axle bracket. All right, we're ready to put our upper arm on, and this arm has adjustment to it. So for rule of thumb, what I like to do is to screw that in. And I like for it to be at least 3/4 of an inch inside that tube, so I know I have a good strength as far as how many threads are inside the tube. For safety reasons, obviously, you don't want to just have a couple threads or it could rip it out. So we've got that where I like it. Now, the kit comes with an adjustment setup for your upper arm. So what you'll do with it is once you set this where you want it, and this has to do with your pinion angle adjustment, and from where I'm starting at, I have set this alignment jig to match what's here on the actual control arm. So we're going to take the alignment jig, which we install with the same bolts that come in for the upper arm, and we're going to put them up here and set it into position like the control arm would be in. So that's representing the upper arm. Now, with the kit, you also have these mounts that go to your axle. Now, because Ford offers lots of different variations of 9-inch axles, you'll have some that with the extra support coming down at an angle, different tube sizes, you may have to modify these brackets in order for it to work on your application. They are talking about maybe offering some alternate bracketry, but in the meantime, you can trim or add to, or whatever you need to do to make this work. So what we ended up doing was actually remade them ourselves to make it work on this application. Before we go to that point, we actually set the car down on the ground with the tires and wheels on it, and we got it to the ride height that we want to have with the car. So we actually cut some off-road rod to the ride height that we wanted and tacked them into place to hold the axle at the ride height that we like. Then we came in and set up this bracketry using the temporary upper. Rule of thumb is that you want your measurement to be from the center line of axle to the center of the hole. It needs to be 3.5 inches, and you want your axle bolt and your front bolt to be parallel with the ground in order to have the correct geometry. You may roll these brackets back or forward or up or notch or whatever you need to do to obtain the 3.5 inches from center line of hole to center line of axle. Once you've got that in place, you tack it into position, do both sides. And the other critical part is that you want your rear end to be centered. If your axles are still in the rear end, take your straight edge here and hold it up from off of your rear end, measure over to your straight edge so that you have the same measurement from side to side. If your axles are not in the rear end, then you would use your axle flange as that reference. Once you've got that into position, that's a good time to go ahead and tack these into place. That way the rear end won't move. Then carry on with the procedure here. And then once you're happy with all that, you actually install your upper arm. Come back and start doing your welding. So do about 1-inch bead, swap to the other side, and go back and forth till you finish complete welding. I recommend that you weld both the outside and the inside for the ultimate strength. In this case, we don't have the engine and transmission already in there, so setting up perfect pinion angle is not an option at this point. So that's the beauty of the adjustment on your upper arm, is now we can come in and move this in and out and adjust our pinion angle to get it correct to line up with our driveline. The upper control arm, you put the adjustable end towards the front of the car, and before you put your bolt in, you have two shims, spacers, that go on. The smaller end goes towards the arm, and the bolt goes through the bracket into that. So you feed that through, and you have one on the other side as well. All right, that completes the install. So now we're going to come back in and do some welds, and then we're going to take the arm off and then finish the welds because we don't want to put too much heat on these bushings.
Well, Alan, this looks really cool. So this car's basically got to have everything done to it. You're going to pull all this back out again,
right,
so that you can finalize your welds on the axle, get everything looking really super nice underneath here. I have to say, though, it's a nice looking kit. I really like it. like it.
Yep, it is very nice.
Now, what are they going to do about exhaust? Because I know it's a custom system, so you're going to have to get something custom bent for it. Now, if you were going to do this, you said something to me about running it on the outside of the rails.
We did a similar rear end up set up before, and the exhaust actually came over this way. But there's room to do other things. It's just not something you pick up a catalog or an exhaust system for. You're going to have to take it to an exhaust guy and have them custom make it for you.
Well, even so, I tell you, when you get this thing done, man, I'd sure like to see it on the road and see how this thing handles and operates. Gonna be a little ways down the road, but hey, we can come back and pick that up.
Right.
Well, folks, that's our show for this week. Do us a favor and come back and watch us next time on Autorestomod. Have a great week. I'm out.